On 16th April, we celebrated the 10th anniversary of the revival of Panna Tiger Reserve in Madhya Pradesh. It is a one-of-a-kind story in the entire world where we went from local extinction of tigers from a perfectly good habitat in 2009 to 60 tigers in a matter of 10 years. It is a success story that is so widely and rightly celebrated today and has become a model and motivating force for other conservation attempts. But it came with its own huge set of challenges 10 years back. Let us hear the untold story of Panna from Dr. K. Ramesh of WII as he tells us how a lot of unsung heroes played their roles to a T. And as Dr. Ramesh says, with the heart and mind together, in order to give us this exceptional conservation success. Let us hear the story now.
I think I would say it's a very nice to connect with this because I personally think that this kind of information should go to a larger audience. So that Panna as a story has a lot of interesting insight to gain from both for science, management, awareness, the livelihood. To me, as a professional, I used to work in the mountain. I always love mountain. My PhD was from the mountain areas and things like that. And while working in the mountain, I always felt that the Himalaya is one of the really best. I think I still feel that. But I always felt that the tiger as a species was taking undue advantage of being charismatic and with a lot of popular support. And people were funding and much of the research on tiger or a lot of activities were on tigers much more. So I always used to tell myself that I will never work on tiger. So that is where I want to start with. Tiger was not one of those kind of species for me as a professional career, but I generally approach from a very scientific principle. So, but then when I became a faculty member of the Wildlife Institute in 2008, the first assignment that I received was about Panna's tiger. So, as a researcher, as an independent scientist, you probably have a choice to do what you want. But as a government servant, even a scientist working with a government servant, our foremost the mandate or the obligation is to look at what the government wants. So Panna was at the crossroad then. It was in 2008. There was so much of hue and cry because by the time Sariska had happened, Sariska tiger extinction had happened already, and the entire nation was basically talking about it. Prime Minister got involved, and there was a committee set up. So using a tiger reserve was not taken very lightly. I think the high-level committees were set up, and then it was actually a committee led by Dr. Sunita Narayan. They came up with an excellent document called the Joining the Dots. Very classic document because it narrates the problems in the country as a whole. Although it was meant for Sariska, but the whole issue about India's conservation. So where we are faltering and where are the silver linings, how to go about it. So restocking, reintroducing tiger was one of the agenda. They had laid out several agenda, research agendas, several agendas were there. So, but then Madhya Pradesh always said to be one of the very key state for wildlife conservation in general. While Sariska happening, there was also population decline that was observed in Panna. So this was a story before me, and it's very important to know because that was a story where people generally don't talk about it. Because when you talk about tigers, Panna tiger recovery, it's only about when you started in 2009 and now. But before that, there was a decline, and the decline was pointed out by some of the scientists. I mean, I mean, I would say specifically, Dr. Chindawat was a scientist from the in the Wildlife Institute, but then he resigned later. He was working in Panna for a very long time. So he observed the decline in tiger population and then started, you know, communicating it. So this happened. At the same time, the department also had its own version saying that, you know, this decline may be decline, but it probably is not very alarming. So there was a kind of a, you know, two ways expressions of tiger population declining to an extinction status, the other side saying that yes, it is probably not that alarming. So there are several people went there to look at it, but unfortunately, I mean, maybe because that time the science was not, you know, well advanced, even though the camera trap was introduced in India back in 2000, Panna was one of the sites where camera traps are set up. But somehow things did not go as it was expected, with the, both the sides, you know, talking about the number and kind of blaming each other. So, but then it was in 2008, there was definitely a requirement for us to look at what is the real situation. So that's when me and one of my colleagues, Dr. Johnson, got dropped there. So a person who never wanted to work on tiger got dropped there. In fact, I did work briefly about a year and a half with Dr. Johnson on a tiger. So that background was with me. So I think this me entering into this Panna was a kind of a calculated decision by director, Mr. P.R. Sinha, because he probably wanted somebody who did not belong to any lobby, but still have scientific background or the technical know-how. So that is how I went there as a part of the team to actually look at what went wrong in Panna. So when we started looking at Panna with a completely very systematic approach, so we went with the camera trap, went with the line transit, we had a team of four people. So we spent quite a bit of time trying to see what was the situation there. So after having surveyed for about 3 months, so we kind of figured out the habitat is really fantastic, because by the time village relocation program was one of the very prominent activities that happened in Panna. So people have relocated about 13 villages then. So it was a kind of inviolate space to have. So it's an ideal area for tiger. Anybody would like to say that, oh, this is one of the good habitat. So after having done the systematic assessment, we could really find that the habitat is there, the prey is there, the tigers are missing. And even we surveyed in the area when we went in the nighttime. I think it's a entirely different experience to be in the tiger area. Absence of tiger, you can feel it as much as the presence of tiger. Okay. The absence of tiger means that the forest looks so dry and empty, very quiet. So, but then by the time 2008, we could find out evidence of only one tiger. We had got the camera trap picture also. We compared it. That was a picture of 2006. People had captured it. And no, you could say, okay, this was the same tiger, male tiger. But by the time in February 2009, even the evidence of this tiger was also lost. So therefore, by 2009, every one of us realized it. The report was already, the interim report we submitted to the government, to NTCA and the state government, that yes, Panna is almost, I mean, extinct. I mean, even if you say, that, given the connectivity, even if the tigers are gone here and there, which is what the view of some of the people, there are a couple of committees, there's special investigation team, there's also other committee. But we kind of stated that even if there's one or two tigers, even if you assume it to the remotest chance, it is a functionally extinct. So whether functionally extinction means that it calls for restoring the population. So while we are putting this interim report, the state government of Madhya Pradesh realized that yes, we couldn't basically carry on with this. So the male is there. Maybe let us bring the two females first. So they approached the central government to get two females. So both the females were actually started as a augmentation program. So if you bring both the females, the male probably would stay back, so that, no, we will not call it as a total extinction. So the proposal was mooted, but by the time these animals came, so even the male had disappeared. So what started as an augmentation program became a, had to become a full-fledged reintroduction program. So this was initial set of our experience of going there and, you know, meeting people and talking to them. In fact, we've been talking to a lot of people. So part of this survey, we did assessment with respect to the prey availability, the disturbance, trying to interview with people. So we found that, you know, tiger population could recover with good protection, because poaching risk was always there. So those areas around Madhya Pradesh, Katni and all, it's with people who have the past been very actively involved in poaching. So with that, we had to go for proper species recovery strategy. So we did a proper reintroduction program. The only, I would say, most important advantage which the Panna had as compared to many other sites were, the habitat was intact. The prey base were good. So you really don't have to do so much of other background preparation as compared to many other sites. If other sites, if it is a Sahyadri, if it is many other sites where I've been involved in, if you have to rebuild a tiger, you have to do so many things before. So look at the habitat, improve the, you know, habitat quality, remove the disturbance, bring in the prey population. Everything was an ideal situation except the protection. But then that time, because this animosity or this conflict was so high, people did not trust the management of Panna that well. Although the chief wildlife warden and then chief wildlife had confidence, but even among the officers fraternity and the conservation community, they thought Panna is a bad model. Panna is a kind of a place which has committed a crime. So for me also, it was kind of, people said, oh, it's a taboo. But then our director, I mean, we always looked at it very passionately. I still remember very well when I had my first interaction with the director about this particular case. He said, Mr. Besana, amazing administrator. He told me, Ramesh, dil aur dimag laga ke kaam karna hai. This was a statement. I still remember that. Because whenever you work on this kind of program, I think both these are important. Heart and mind need to work together. So I just find, being a scientist, you are supposed to be dispassionate. But it doesn't work that way. So you have to be passionate both from science and from the place or the species that you work with. I think that particular statement by him, it's very vivid. I always take that word even today, whatever work that I do. So I think these two Hindi words remains very strong in my mind. So now with the taboo situation, even within the Madhya Pradesh, there was issue, because initially Dr. H.S. Pabla was a chief wildlife warden. So he was also blamed for letting the tiger population go down. So Panna to the world now might look like a conservation story around one or two elements. We may call it, you know, it's like a good place, leadership, people working hard, staff working hard. I mean, it's all been stated time and again. But then I always thought that when we work in conservation field, whether it's a scientist or a managers, we are supposed to work that way. I think when you're posted, we have a passion as well as hard work, it's bound to happen. So why I'm trying to highlight this, when I said this untold story of Panna, because there are many elements which is part of the story which made Panna today. There are many people who have been part of the history. They must have played small and big role, but these were all very crucial that point in time. So there's Mr. Lalan Chowdhury was the field director then, when actually the tiger reintroduction program started. Nobody probably even knows his name. So he was very much part of that. But first two tiger coming there. These are the two females, which they call it T1, T2 in Panna. One, the T1 came from Bandhavgarh and T2 came from Kana. So during his time, and Mr. Pabla himself taking on the responsibility, he himself went to both the sites, both in Bandhavgarh and in Kana, brought the tiger. So what happened was, see, by the time we are still completing studies, you look at that. So we are not done with it. March, we are finishing the work in terms of what went wrong and things like that. But by the time this one female came, Bandhavgarh female came, I think it was like quietly in the month of March 3rd, I remember, they brought the tiger and I think they kept the enclosure. We were there, it was released. And then by the time we knew this tiger has come, it was a big news all over. Now, the second female has to come. It seems that the field officers in Kana had identified some tiger that would be the potential animal to come. But when they went there to capture, the entire tourism lobby opposed tiger translocation Panna. So there was a huge protest in Kana at the entrance gate. And people gathered and said that, you know, we will not allow tiger to go from here. But Mr. Pabla, with his conviction, I mean, he managed to talk to the Air Force and convinced them to bring helicopter. They brought the helicopter and lifted this way of bringing by road. I don't think Panna would have seen the second female. So it is not that they had bad intention to block the tiger, but it's a good intention that, okay, here tigers are there in the tourism zone. People are seeing this, you know, these visitors are coming. At the same time, if you lifted this Panna, Panna is already demonstrated to be bad. So with that intention, they said no. I also remember, I mean, even some of these officers who were posted there, they were not very happy sharing tiger because of good intention again, saying, because there's no trust of the people who are managing Panna. So these two females came, but now, by the time we knew, because it was expected that if you keep these two females, maybe even the male that kind of disappeared in the month of February would probably return. But nothing of that had happened. Now we were left with two females. This is again a functional extinction case. So even though you may have individual, but both are females with no male. So this is when the important, I would say, the game changer of Panna happened here. So we were monitoring these animals. I remember when the first T1, T2, they took a lot of time to settle down. So female tigers, they're very careful when they go to a new place. They explore slowly, slowly, steadily, and then they establish themselves. So yes, we were happy at least these tigers have stayed on and these animals. Initially, WLF was part of the story. They had donated a radio collar. So both the collars that we initially had on the tigers were coming from WLF. Mr. Ravi Singh has always been very, you know, passionate man when it comes to proactive conservation. So without thinking twice, he always, you know, comes forward to support. So this happened. So one of my colleague, Dr. Arindran, who is still with the WLF, is heading this the IGCMC. He had come because he brought it, you know, because all the radio collar was done by our team, WI scientists. But he had come to the field and things like that. So, but then by the time it was June, and got dropped of the T2, the animal which came from Kana called, got dropped. It posed a big challenge for the monitoring team. So one animal had a collar, other animal did not have. But even then, these collars did not work for very long. So we had to change the collar quickly. So this particular collar just worked for 3 months and then dropped. And they had one excellent forester. So he was with a team, they were tracking, there's a team of mine, already had a researchers team. They were also monitoring tiger day by day. So now with this, things are not going to go forward. The department decided to change guard and then brought Mr. Srinivasamurthy around, I think, in June, if I remember correctly, June 2009. Because by the time these two females had settled, the T1 and T2 had settled, but we had to bring another male now. So this was a decision. So we overall, I mean, this was a decision by department. NTC was always be initially, you know, the NTC was a part of this whole program because they only asked us to go and evaluate and then develop the species recovery program. So they had identified a male in Bandhavgarh. So we from Wildlife Institute are asked to go there and see the suitability and translocate. So the male was identified. It was beautiful in the range, Thala range. It was a nice animal. So when we went there, when we got the detail, so along with me was Mr. Subharanjan Sen, who was a forest officer from the Madhya Pradesh Cadre, but he was a defensive. Okay. So we both went there. When we saw, this animal was actually a sibling of the earlier female that had come to Panna. So they had kind of identified the sibling. So because in field, this general understanding is that, so the siblings mate, you know, those kind of options are available. So that is general understanding, there's no problem. But from a scientific perspective, from the population growth model perspective, I was very clear. And I'm convinced Mr. Subharanjan Sen that we were not taking this animal. And it was not that is when I'm meeting Mr. Srinivasamurthy. He had come from Panna to Bandhavgarh to take this animal. We were supposed to go and evaluate and put the radio, send it, give it to him kind of thing. I mean, there's one person, Mr. Shukla, Dharmendra Shukla. He was APCCF. He was made as mission leader, amazing leader. He was always open to discussion and things like that. So even though he was very receptive to many ideas, he was trying to convince us, yes, it's fine. But then when we really put our foot down, I would say that was a turning point, because we put foot down and the more onus became on us. Now we need to bring tiger from elsewhere. So we suggested the next option could be pinch. Pinch was, because I still remember that Mr. Shukla was talking to different officers, whether they have additional animal, male, Kana, I think they refused, other places they refused. The pinch was the only option. So by the time monsoon, we can't do this. We decided that we do this translocation after monsoon. I remember, I think we started off in October. There was a field director, Dr. Kageshwar Nayak. So I would always give credit to him. If there is a Panna success story, in addition to what we've been talking about, the former field director and many other field directors, he was a man who made sure Panna gets the male. It was not like any other site. Bandhavgarh, they probably just took one day. Kana, probably they just identified and then 2 days. But in pinch, it took us 45 days to capture the tiger. So we were camping there all the 45 days. I still remember many of my colleagues used to make fun here. Along with the tiger, Ramesh has been translocated to Panna. So every day morning, this gentleman, Kageshwar Nayak, will wake up too early and collect his staff, talk to them, get an evidence of animals, where all the tigers are. So in the morning itself, we'll have a list of tigers recorded from different places. So we would then identify. So on a couple of occasions, we narrowed down. We went close, but it turned out it was female. So because you have to see this, it is not Panna was first case. Now we can learn a lot from Panna. For Panna to happen, there was no prior experience or prior knowledge or prior expertise. Yes, Sariska happened, but Sariska happened with one source population from Ranthambur. They had no other options. They were just translocating tiger from there. Those Ranthambur tigers were closely monitored. Everybody knew. But here, it was a kind of a challenge. But Panna, Madhya Pradesh has a very good team of variants and domestic elephants. And that's where Madhya Pradesh is well ahead, because they have most of the technical support system with them. So when we went there, so one of the occasions, I still remember, you know, the kind of behavioral expressions of elephant, domestic elephants. On one occasion, this particular female was there, the bush, the elephant would not go forward. I was on elephant back. There's somebody's elephant back. It would not. It sensed this tigress is very aggressive. But then we were so desperate. We were going down. We're pushing it. We pushed it. This tigress came. But at some point in time, she charged at us. She just came zoom from the lantana bush towards us. It's like this. I could see the tiger face to face. You can imagine. You know? Within a second, it just came and then the elephant pulled back. So a couple of such incidents happened. And finally, this male was kind of caught. So we were getting into a very desperate situation. You can imagine that 45 days non-stop, people are trying, you know. Hats off to Mr. Kageshu Nayak, he made. I think I would say the male coming from pinch was a turning point. Otherwise, nobody was giving tiger to Panna. Now we are talking about giving tiger from Madhya Pradesh to Satkoshia, other states, even we are talking about other countries. In 2009, people were not even willing to give the tiger for within the state for all good intention. So, given the background Panna had, this male was caught. I was also in experience at that point in time with radio call ring. We had very little time. So, everybody was like learning. So, when the tiger was there, the immediate thing in our mind was to bring the tiger to a safe place. We were just three of us, the veterinarians, and this, everybody was staying behind. We were only four of us when darted. So the tiger was down there. We just quickly went down and tried to make sure the tiger is alive and then brought it. We hardly had any time. So we couldn't radio collar this animal. So we brought this tiger without radio collaring to Panna because we wanted the tiger. Radio collar can happen later, but tiger must come. That was their idea. We really wanted to have the tiger. So it was, at the end, it all turned out very nicely. It was brought by road all the way from Pench via Jabalpur, and then we reached of the early morning, very early morning. So now again, look at these experiences. These are the first time happening. So we had a cage, nice cage. So the tiger was brought, and then it was still in a very sedated condition, but by the time it came, it was fully awake. But then it was probably slept. The cage was such that, you know, it is sufficient enough to sleep. So it was brought down. There's a place there already identified Panna called Badgadi. It was brought down. When we saw, because the cages, when they're kept down, I saw this one of the cage, that side, the lock was not proper. So the tiger was coming down. When they brought it down, I was holding the position. I was standing there, the tiger just woke up. He didn't actually push. Had she pushed, she probably would have come out. He just only charged. So I was just holding it immediately. They just locked it. So, but it looked so unprofessional at that point in time. But then what I would like to say, you know, to the people, the conservation comes with the combination of experiences, expertise, professionalism. And there are not many people in this world even today. So, but what Panna has seen now as a perfect model has started with imperfect situations, but never lost the mind and heart. So kept the composure and cool. That is what we are seeing now. It's all come from, as I said, multiple experiences, multiple people had played at different point in time. So after that, yes, everything was fine. Everybody's happy. We released the tiger. But then, since it's a male, we kept the tiger for a long time. It was there for about a week and more. So there's a lot of interesting stuff there. Because when we released the tiger, we had kept one of those bait outside. There was also bait inside, but he did not touch the bait at all. Even when we kept the bait outside, we were just waiting. But unfortunately, by the time when you're releasing, it was started raining that day. So when the gate was released, I could see the tiger was coming. I still have the picture. The tiger was coming out of the gate. And the first thing the tiger sees a buffalo calf. But any tiger in any situation would have given a whack or it eaten. It was not eaten. It was like a buffalo calf looking at a tiger, you know, as a look. It was a beautiful scene. So this calf does not know, just giving a very comfortable look towards tiger. Tiger is just quietly walking away. So it was a situation where you would not expect that kind of thing happen. But yes, that is how the behavior is. Because when the tiger was under stress, the first thing that looks at is to escape from the place of confinement. Rest comes later. So when the male was released, he stayed inside 2 weeks and made a kill. After a kill, he started exploring. So in between, the people observed some injury on this animal. They thought, okay, we need to go and address this animal. So, but then they decided, okay, maybe we should take care of the health and then try to see whether the injury was real or not. But the tiger probably was not very comfortable with the elephant going close, so it started moving. Then he started moving across the river. So once across the river means for us it's a panic. There's a Ken River, which is basically in Panna. Once it crosses, then the entire department got together. No, we don't want to let the animal go. So people made a strategy to chase the animal inside. So there was a time then you could see this, you know, chase inside. But after getting cornered, the tiger responded initially, it's coming towards Panna. But beyond a point, when he realized that, you know, it was being cornered, he completely took an opposite walk. So he kept walking, going back. So he walked about 230 plus kilometer and making a total walk of 447, I would say, I think it's kilometer in the whole landscape in 6 weeks' time. So everybody was mad in this Murthy. That's when he made this whole team. He put a lot of effort in following this tiger and going one by one, you know, making one steps, calling up people, collaborating with the different departments, you know? So it was constantly, because by the time the radio caller that we had put, I mean, we had actually in between, we dotted it and put a radio caller. So before releasing it, it all happened. But in satellite, that time we had the VHF with satellite caller. Satellites would come intermittently because this ravines would not allow. So sometimes you lose signal, sometimes you don't get a GPS. All these things happen. But one of my researcher was tracking, so he finally found the signal and then found out where the tigers were. So it reached to a point, it crossed Noradi, went to the other forest, adjoining forest. So the situation became such that we had to make a decision as to what to happen, because this animal has been tranquilized twice before. Once to Captain Pinch, and after a couple of weeks, after a week in Panna for radio collaring, now the animal had to be captured. So I still remember, I think there's one gentleman, Mr. Yadav, was documenting the whole thing. Mr. Srinivasa Murthy, you know, who's the director, he made a statement that we will capture it and release it in pinch. Because this animal is having a strong homing instinct, maybe it will not stay back. So that was his vision. Because any animal with a homing instinct will not stay. It's like our cat. How much ever you try to release it, it will come back. So he was convinced that, you know, it has a homing instinct. That's why it's walking towards pinch and things like that. So he said, no, let's capture it and release it in bench, because here it is not safe, because that area has a lot of electrocution issues and things like that. But I was of the view that either you leave this tiger in the landscape, maybe it might come back, or bring it back to Panna. So that was another turning point, I would say, which many people may not know. So the tiger was captured again, it was brought back. So now the Panna, the population that you see, is made of these three individuals. The growth rate has been exceptional, partly because all three animals have come from three different populations. It's proven, no, multiple times, that animals from a different gene pool have better productivity. So that is one of the biggest reason how Panna has proliferated in terms of the population growth. The fact of the matter is that because of this intervention and strong opinion, I would say, from the Wildlife Institute, because my director was backing all the time, and we made these opinions, strong statements, so they accepted it and we've been able to back. So from our point of view, I was there with the team to provide the technical support. We continue to provide the technical support, and we have been there even now. So after these three animals come, and quickly in 2010, 16 April, so the cubs of the T1 was found. So that's how people are celebrating. So to me, every year is a celebration. So I always felt that, you know, conservation, something must be celebrated, because it's a celebration. Partly also means that all those people who have been part of the story is remember. You remember them. It is not to glorify one's accomplishment. It's remember the contribution of each and every individual, small and big, because conservation is never a single or individualized endeavor. It's an institutional or team endeavor. So I always felt happy to be part of Panna, because having come from background where, you know, I've never been exposed to all this, and working in the mountain and coming and seeing a local extinction by myself, and then seeing a population recovery, I think it's an excellent experience to me as a personally, as a professionally. So this three happened, but by the time 2010, this animal gave litter, but the other female, the two did not have collar, so we couldn't monitor, because their only monitoring is based on pug mark. So my team and this Mr. Amar Singh, when I said the forester, he was there, he used to have a team, he used to monitor every day. I think in the month of November in 2010. So I was very much there in the field, and we had this deputy director, Mr. Vikram Singh Parihar, along with Dr. Gupta, who was a veterinarian there. So we were trying to see through, because that time we were searching for this other animal. We thought we'll go and try to capture so that we can radio collar, because the radio collar is not working for too long now. So when we went there, this team elephant, the trackers, they found this animal. They found the animal, they came back saying that, sir, the animal is with cub now. So we discovered the animal next time with the cub. So we decided not to put the radio collar immediately. So we allowed that to happen. By the time it the young ones grew up, so we have a situation in 2010, both the females have with litter. So now, as part of the tiger recovery strategy, we have to bring four females and two males. So we are now done only one male and two females. There are some people always recommend that when you do a reintroduction, you try to put as many animals as possible initially, let it develop. But Panna, I think I feel that way, because Panna was developing very systematically. Three, the cubs, by the cubs were there. So I didn't feel that, you know, bringing more animals will be very good at this point in time. We never know what kind of fight might happen and things like that. But even then, there were not option also. People are also not giving more tigers even then. So then there was a captive raised orphan cubs, which was raised in captivity and was in semi-wild condition, trained again by Mr. Kagesh Nayak in Kana. So those two animals became a choice. So we had a lot of discussions, agreement, disagreement to bring this animal at that point in time. But then we were convinced that, you know, let's do it as an experiment, not as a part of the program. So some of these two animals also came in 2011. So this captive animal were brought in. After that, there was another female was brought from a bench. Then there was other male which was staying in Bhopal. So that was captured and brought in. So kind of finished this in a different stage with a different composition. But then the phase one, which we thought, like we call it, like every phase, we call it 5 years. So the population growth in Panna was exceptional. Usually you expect cub mortality to be 50%. That's a model. We were only talking about 10 to 12% because the cub mortality was very low. Adult mortality was very low. The population in Panna grew very fast. So from one in 2008, zero in early 2009, and three animals. So Panna reached this carrying capacity within 5 years. I mean, in terms of what visualizes the carrying capacity then. But now Panna tiger population is beyond 60, with 40 in the park and 20 of them dispersed outside. So what was a sing population, what was an extinct population, is become a source population in a way. Many animals have gone from here to one animal. Some animals have been picked up from here, gone into Satpura, You also know that one tiger crossed and gone into Bandhavgarh. So it has now reached to a kind of an ideal tiger population. So I think both from the local, national and global context, the Panna story of tiger recovery is exceptional. It is an experience. It's a learning. Yeah, it must be seen as an experience learning, both for tiger conservation in India and outside. So in nutshell, these whole experiences, what made it happen, I would say, the institutional arrangement of those things. I think I would still feel that even we are there, we are looking at exit policy. Everything is institutionalized. There's institution, the state government, NTCA, Wildlife Institute, everybody was playing the role. So obviously any conservation activity, somebody has to own it. The state government was very keen to own it. They were actually owning it. And there's a leadership. So all the leadership, starting from Alan Chowdhury, I think every field director, over time they come in. I mean, obviously Mr. Murthy came in at the right time when the two females came and settled, and the male came and make it settle. And subsequent protections and strategies, motivations among staff, which I think then after that we had field director coming and they playing the role. Even today there's a field director who's playing his role to sustain this population. I think all this leadership made this possible. And the intensive monitoring, I think Panna had an excellent monitoring by the staff, 24/7. Okay, and there is a scientific monitoring by a research team. So many people outside the world may not even know, since 2008, the team from Wildlife Institute is continuously present there. So playing the role very quietly. So this has been a very conscious decision to us, because we've seen this, how conservation can become a problem when more than one player trying to overstep others when it comes to being on the visible side of it. So we always made sure that researchers play the support role. And first phase, the year from 2009 to 2014, we were very proactive. We were involved in total every aspects of tiger activities monitoring. The phase two, we stepped back. We are playing only a crisis role. When there's a crisis or support role, when they need, because provide some technical, when there is requirement, and then monitoring. So 2010, now the 2020, we are now going to be an exit from the recovery mode. The tiger introduction for us, it's over. Now it has to be managed like any other tiger population. So Wildlife Institute probably will pull back from that role. We will probably continue to be there as long as possible, by monitoring, making sure what we achieved continue to remain. Because with this tiger number reaching to 60, we are experiencing new challenges. The new challenge can always revert the situation if you're not careful, if you don't address it in all aspects. Thinking about from population area to a large landscape and look at conflicts, activity, trying to improve the habitat within, beyond. So these are the aspects currently we're looking at from both scientific point of view. So in nutshell, Panna, as I said, it's been an excellent journey for me personally, professionally. And I would say that, this is a kind of a conservation model that one should emulate. It is not for only the reintroduction. When I say conservation model, when there are situations like this, how do you respond? How do you work together? Who takes lead role when? Who plays? I mean, it's really, sometimes with the conservation, it's very easy for people to get carried away. Just for whatever that provides some recognition. But important is to keep the focus in mind. Dil aur dimag laga ke, we have to start and continue the work. That's all I would say. Thank you so much.